Welcome to worship. I have some good news to share. Our church session has approved having our first in-person worship service in our sanctuary for Sunday, June 27th at 10 a.m. We ask that everyone planning to attend this service pre-register or RSVP through our church website or through a link that will be provided in the church e-news. You can also call the church office to RSVP. We ask for information that will help us plan for the service. We ask so that we will know the number of people planning to come and how many of those are fully vaccinated. This will help us plan the seating arrangement in the sanctuary so that everyone who comes will feel welcome and safe. In what you might call a practice for this, we are having our second outdoor prayer service in the courtyard of the church next Sunday, June 6th at 3 p.m. We ask that you pre-register for this prayer service using the same link and the same form as we will have for our inside service on June 27th. Now, this information will not probably be as important for an outdoor service as it is for an indoor service, but it will give us a chance, you might say, to test drive our registration process. That's why we encourage people to use it for our outdoor prayer service. We can use this to test drive our registration process to see it, to make sure it's easy to do and works properly. Finally, we will also have a sort of test drive for indoor worship on Friday, June 18th at 11 a.m. when we have a special memorial service inside our sanctuary for Shirley Spencer. That will be Friday, June 18th at 11 a.m. More details will be coming. Now let's prepare our hearts to worship God.
Sisters and brothers, please join me in prayer. Though our thoughts may scatter like kids out to play, you, God, are the wise teacher that gathers them in. You are the touchstone we strive to focus on. Dearest Lord, gather together all our hopes, fears, strengths, failings, as you lovingly bring us closer to the life you desire for us. This day especially, we ask you to bring our thoughts and cares to the veterans of our military, the men, women, and families who have given and are still giving so much, even their lives, so that we may live as a democracy. We honor the lives that are taken, but we ask especially that you bring comfort and relief to those still fighting and suffering with the scars and memories they cannot escape. We pray for peace in their lives and peace in the world. Hear us now as we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Today, for our Celebrating with Children time, I have a story to share. It's about a special little turtle named Truman. That's the title of the book. It's written by Jean Reedy and illustrated by Lucy Ruth Cummins. Truman was small, the size of a donut, and every bit as sweet. He lived with his Sarah, high above honking taxis and growling trash trucks and shrieking cars and the number 11 bus, which traveled south. Truman never honked or growled or shrieked at anybody or anything. He was peaceful and pensive, just like his Sarah. One day, Sarah ate a big banana with her breakfast, clipped a blue bow in her hair, and buttoned up a brand new sweater. She strapped on a backpack so big, 32 small tortoises could ride along in it. But zero tortoises did. Sarah placed 7 green beans in Truman's dish, 2 more than usual. She kissed her finger and touched it to his shell and whispered, "Be brave, Then she left. Not to worry, she'd left before and she'd always returned, but this time, that backpack was particularly big, and Sarah looked particularly pensive, and that banana, and that bow, and let's not forget about those extra beans. That's when Truman saw something he'd never seen before. Sarah boarding the number 11 bus going south. The bus roared away. Truman waited for Sarah to return. He waited and waited. He waited 1,000 hours, tortoise hours that is, until he could wait no longer. He would go after his Sarah. He would catch the number 11 south, even amid the honking and the growling and the shrieking, even if it seemed impossible. Bonk. That's when he noticed the rocks, 3 rocks that had always been there. Ordinary rocks that now seemed extraordinary. And the arm of the couch and the pillow propped just right. And that tall, tall boot and the rug, that glorious, endless rug. Without Sarah, their home seemed vast and uncharted and unsettling. Truly unsettling. But perhaps the most unsettling was that Truman could no longer see the taxis, or the trash trucks, or the cars, or the number 11 bus. Which way was south, anyway? Now the sun hung low like Truman's head and heart. Just then, and then, screech, whish, up floors and under doors, Truman heard it. A bus. It was time. Time to catch the number 11 south. Amid the honking and the growling and the shrieking, yet standing there in that ray of light, Truman felt peaceful and pensive and brave. But just as he was about to slip under the door, through that opening barely the size of a small tortoise, Sarah! She spotted him, shining like the sun. Truman! She cried. She scooped him up and said things like, "Oh my goodness!" and "You!" and "How did you ever?" and "Amazing!" Sarah kissed her finger and touched it to his shell and tucked him back safely in his tank where he was peaceful and pensive and proud. And later, just before bedtime, she read him a story. Now Truman knew that one day soon he and his Sarah might travel south, to see new sights and hear new sounds and think new thoughts together. Well, in our scripture story today, the disciples are afraid. They've seen their teacher, their beloved leader, killed by those authorities, and they're worried. They're hiding behind closed doors. Into this fear, though, comes Jesus. He offers his disciples peace and the gift of his Spirit. And he promises to be with them, his presence to stay with them, He even meets Thomas again, and he lets Thomas touch his wounds to show him that he is truly alive again. To the disciples, back then, after Easter, way back then, when they encountered Jesus alive again, and to us now, Jesus offers the gifts of peace and life and the Holy Spirit to be with us. Just like Truman the turtle understood that Sarah was not leaving him for good, disciples then and now have Christ's presence with us, and we are called to follow him in faith. Please pray with me. Lord Jesus Christ, thank you that when you left, you didn't leave us alone, but you left us with your presence, your Holy Spirit among us. Your Holy Spirit, like a tongue of flame, like a wind blowing, like the breath that fills us. Thank you that you will never leave us. Amen.
I was sure by now, God, you would have reached down and wiped our tears away, stepped in and saved the day. But once again, I'll say amen. And it's still raining, but as the thunder rolls, I barely hear you whisper through the rain, I'm with you. And as your mercy falls, I'll raise my hands and praise the God who gives and takes away. And I'll praise you in this storm, and I will lift my hands, for you are who you are, no matter where I am, and every tear I cry, you hold in your hands, you never left my side, and though my heart is torn, I will praise you in this storm. I stumbled in the wind, you heard my cry to you and raised me up again. But my strength is almost gone, how can I carry on if I can't find you? But as the thunder rolls, I barely hear you whisper through the rain, I'm with you. Your mercy falls, I'll raise my hands and praise the God who gives and takes away. And I'll praise you in this storm, and I will lift my hands, for you are who you are, no matter where I am, and every tear I cry, you hold in your hands, you never
I invite you to pray with me our prayer of confession. The words are printed on the screen. Let us pray. Gracious God, our sins are too heavy to carry, too real to hide, and too deep to undo. Set us free from a past that we cannot change. Open us to a future in which we can be changed. And grant us the grace to grow more and more into your likeness and image through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Before we finish this winter-spring sermon series on the Gospel of John, let us remember again these words of forgiveness from John chapter 3. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that whoever believes in him may not perish, but have eternal life. Friends, believe that good news, that in Jesus Christ we are forgiven and made new. The peace of Christ be with you all. Amen. Sometimes at this point in our church service, we have a Minutes for Ministry about some mission project our church supports, a work of God in the community or in our world that we help support through our witness and action mission giving. But sometimes we have people in our church share the story of God's mission in their own life, the work that God is doing in their own hearts and lives. And today we have such a story shared with us by Dave Kistler. Dave was ordained as an elder in our church in 1985, and most recently has been an active participant in the race relations learning experiences sponsored by our Micah 6:8 Commission. Here is some of Dave's story.
My name's Dave Kistler, and I'm an elder at Southminster. And you know something about being an elder at Southminster? You're an elder for life. But you know something even better? I was baptized at Southminster. And I started on a journey here that I'm still working through. I've always had anger issues, and it's a struggle when you have anger issues, because it affects how you think. It affects how you love. It affects how you care about other people. So today, I'm going to give you a journey in faith in 4 minutes. Some things you just can't do yourself. You can change yourself, but sometimes you can't do it alone. And so there's grace that comes from God, and it flows freely. All you have to do is reach out, open your heart, and let it fill you up. When you have anger issues, they don't go away. You have them every day. Sometimes it's an association. It's like when someone says Black Lives Matter and you have anger. It just boils out of you for some reason and you don't understand why. Well, my journey on faith taught me that the answer to why is to look for the truth in everything. Black Lives Matter too. My life matters too. Your life matters too. And who does it really matter to? Your life matters to God. That's the grace that flows into me, and I can share with you. When you look at me, when you see me, you don't see my anger. You don't see my struggle. You might see my faith. You might see my belief in God. You might just see a crazy guy in front of a camera trying to relate his belief in God. And it really is important to me on an individual basis, but God is a community. a relationship God with God is a dance. And so as I struggle with my anger, with my issues that are real, I ask him to help me deal with those issues. And he's led me on a journey of life that's filled with joy, happiness, sadness, pain, but most of all, an ability to let his grace flow through me. And sometimes when you have questions for God, what you really need to do is just to look at somebody else and say, well, that guy's worse off than I am. And that makes you feel better. But with God, when you look at somebody else, he's hoping you'll see their heart, their love, their grace. So when you think of Black Lives Matter and the Micah Commission at church, you really could ask the question of yourself, like I do, why am I angry? And try to understand the truth of what goes on behind the scenes with people who have anger, who protest, who march. They're just like me. They have anger issues. They love, they cry, they have moments of deep, deep depression. We all do. You know, I think it's okay. God said to me, it's okay. So open up your heart and let the grace flow from him. That's where it all comes from. Thanks.
Please join me in the prayer of dedication. We thank and bless you, Lord, for the means and opportunity to give to your church. We ask that these gifts be used wisely to ease suffering, to feed the hungry, to fight for justice and equality, to educate those seeking to learn, to bring peace to the warring, comfort to the lonely and distressed, and to bring the good news of your loving grace to all. We are your servants, Lord, and we seek to do all these things and more in your holy name. Amen.
Please join me in our prayers of the people. Let us pray. Eternal God, we pray for the world, that through the reconciling love of Christ, our destructive and violent ways may cease as you bless your human family with peace. We pray for the mission of your church, that empowered by your Spirit, we may proclaim the good news of the age in the world you so dearly love. We pray for all who suffer, that together with Christ in his suffering, we may find healing as he did, as he was raised and exalted in you. We pray for your creation, that as it groans for its redemption, we may care for its well-being through the power of your life-giving Spirit. We remember before you those who have died, and pray for those who will die today, that through your glorious redemption that ends all suffering, they may rest with you eternally. Through Christ, with Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, we praise you, O God, now and forever. Amen.
This scripture reading is from the Gospel of John, chapter 1, verses 43 to 51. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now, Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him about whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus, son of Joseph from Nazareth." Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see." When Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him, he said of him, "Here is truly an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." Nathanael asked him, "Where did you get to know me?" Jesus answered, "I saw you under the fig tree before Philip called you." Nathanael replied, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus answered, "Do you believe because I told you that I saw you under the fig tree? You will see greater things than these." And he said to him, "Very truly, I tell you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man."
Our second scripture reading is our final story for this sermon series from the Gospel of John. John chapter 20, verses 19 through 31. It begins on the evening of Jesus' resurrection. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing, you may have life in his name. Please join me in prayer. Lord, in the beginning you spoke your word, and the heavens and earth were created. Then in the fullness of time you sent your Son. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us, full of grace and truth. Now, through the Holy Spirit, speak your word to us again, that we may receive the new life you intend for us through your Son. We pray in his name. Amen. Last week, as I read the story of doubting Thomas in preparation for this sermon, I suddenly noticed something that I had not noticed before. Now, I have preached on this story at least a dozen times before, maybe more. I've read the story countless times. I know the story backward and forward. And yet, last week, as I studied it yet again, I noticed something that I had not noticed before. Actually, two things. And I'm wondering if you noticed them. First, I noticed that Thomas does not demand only to see Jesus before he'll believe in his resurrection. He wants to touch Jesus. Now, I know that's plainly there in the text. It should have been obvious to me, but, you know, that's one of those things I'd never really paid attention to before. Thomas is not satisfied only to see the risen Jesus. He wants to touch him. He wants to put his finger in the mark of the nails in his hand. He wants to put his hand on the wound in Jesus' side where the Roman spear was thrust through him to make sure he was dead. For Thomas, seeing Jesus is not enough because your eyes can deceive you. Maybe what you're seeing is only a dream, or a vision, or a ghost, which is not at all the same as Jesus physically raised from the dead. A vision of Jesus is a private, personal, spiritual experience that you cannot use to prove Jesus' resurrection to anyone else. But touching his physical body, the same physical body that was nailed to the cross, that's how you know that Jesus is risen from the dead. So Thomas wants to touch Jesus before he'll believe. And that brings me to the second thing in the story that I had not noticed before, or at least not paid attention to before. Thomas never does touch Jesus. Did you notice that? Jesus invites Thomas to touch him. Jesus says to Thomas, put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe. Thomas demands to touch Jesus before he will believe, but he never does touch Jesus. Instead, he simply responds to Jesus, my Lord and my God. Thomas demands to touch Jesus before he will believe, but in the end, he believes without ever touching Jesus. Why? The answer, I think, is in Jesus' words to Thomas. Jesus' words proves to Thomas that he knows Thomas. He knows what Thomas said about him. He knows what Thomas is thinking. Supposedly, Jesus wasn't around when Thomas said to the other disciples, unless I put my finger into the mark of his hands and my hand in his side, I will not believe. Jesus wasn't around to hear Thomas say that to the other disciples. But when Jesus shows up and appears to Thomas, the first thing he says to Thomas is, put your finger here and touch the mark on my of the nails on my hands. Put your hand in my side. Do not doubt, but believe. In other words, Jesus has known all along what Thomas is thinking and feeling. He knows Thomas inside out. And that realization is what I think brought Thomas to faith, that Jesus knows him, that Jesus knows his doubts, that Jesus knows his failings, that Jesus knows his skepticism, that Jesus knows everything there is to know about him and still loves him and still wants him to be a disciple, still wants him to be a part of Jesus' eternal family. We've seen this before, actually, in John's gospel. In the first chapter, a story we read way back in January, a disciple named Philip invites his friend Nathanael to come and meet Jesus of Nazareth. But Nathanael replies, can anything good come out of Nazareth? We belittle Thomas for being doubting Thomas, but I mean, Nathanael is downright sarcastic. But when Nathanael meets Jesus, Jesus says to him, here is an Israelite in whom there is no deceit. Meaning, Jesus implies, Nathanael is somebody who says what he thinks. Nathanael says to Jesus, how do you know that? How do you know anything about me? And Jesus says, I saw you under the fig tree before Philip called you. In effect, Jesus is telling Nathanael, I not only know what you said about me, I know everything there is about you that brought you to me. And that leads Nathanael to say, Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel. See, Nathanael at the beginning of John's gospel is the counterpart to Thomas at the end of John's gospel. Nathanael believes in Jesus not because of any miracle that Jesus performs. Jesus has not done any miracles yet at that point in John chapter 1. Nathanael believes in Jesus not because of any miracle that Jesus performed, but because Jesus knows him inside out and still wants a relationship with him, still wants Nathanael to be a part of his eternal family. One more example. We read this story back in February. In John chapter 4, Jesus meets a Samaritan woman at a well. He offers her the water of life, but she thinks Jesus is talking about indoor plumbing. She says to Jesus, give me this water so that I no longer have to come to this well to get it. Then Jesus says to her, go call your husband. The woman says, I have no husband. Jesus says to her, you're right, for you have had five husbands, and the one you have now is not your husband. After this, the woman goes back to her village and says, come see a man who told me everything I ever did. Could this be the Messiah? Notice again, Jesus does no miracle for the woman. He doesn't heal her of any disease. He doesn't give her a miraculous spring of water at her doorstep like she wanted. Instead, he simply spoke to her. But in his words, the woman discovered that Jesus knew her. Jesus knew her inside out and still wanted to give her eternal life. I would like to suggest a new way of reading the Bible. Instead of reading the Bible as if challenging God to prove something to you, try reading the Bible to see what God might reveal in it about you. Instead of reading the Bible challenging God to try to prove something to us, try reading the Bible to see what God might reveal in it about you. I think we saw an example of that in our church service today when Dave Kistler shared his testimony. Dave did not share about some dramatic miracle that God did in his life. He shared about what God revealed to him about himself. He shared an amazing story of grace, how God knew him inside out, just like Thomas, just like Nathanael, just like the woman at the well. God knew him inside out and still wanted a relationship with him, still wanted him to be part of Jesus' eternal family. Just like Thomas, just like Nathanael, just like the woman at the well. On occasion after a church service, I've had someone come up to me and say, Ken, I felt today like you were preaching only to me. Were you? And I usually shrug and say, was I? Which has sometimes led to some interesting pastoral conversations. On other occasions, I've had someone ask, are you eavesdropping on my conversations? Or as someone else put it, how do you know so much about my life? And I tell them, I don't. I don't know all about your life, but God does. And that's why we keep reading the Bible over and over in our church services. Because in the Bible, we not only discover things about God, we discover things about ourselves. Read the Psalms. Read Psalm 73, which in part says, for I was envious of the arrogant. I saw the prosperity of the wicked. for they have no pain. Their bodies are sound and sleek. They are not in trouble as others are. They're not plagued like other people. Have you ever felt that way? See, the Bible is not just a statement of how God feels. In fact, in this case, it's not a statement of how God feels. It's a statement of, it's a revelation of how we sometimes feel. Or consider this statement from Ecclesiastes. I saw all the deeds that are done under the sun, and behold, all is vanity and chasing after wind. That's not a statement of how God feels. That's a revelation of how we sometimes feel. Or listen to these words from the Apostle Paul in Romans chapter 7. I do not understand my own actions, for I do not do the good I want, but the evil I do not want is what I do. Have you ever felt that way? See, I don't have a secret microphone or a hidden camera trained on your life. I'm just reading the Bible. But the Bible reveals things about our lives because God knows what your life is like, including what you have been through and what you're going through now. Meeting God in the Bible is not just about discovering what God has done in the past. It is also about discovering what God knows of your life, of your heart, of your feelings. For when we discover that God knows us inside out, we also discover that God loves us inside out, just like Thomas, just like Nathaniel, just like the woman at the well. When we realize that God knows us inside out, we discover that God loves us inside out and wants for us, just like for Thomas and Nathaniel and the woman at the well, an eternal life with him. Amen.
Dead, it is finished, he said. We had watched as his life ebbed away. Then we all stood around till the guards took him down. Joseph begged for his body that day. It was late afternoon when we got to the tomb, wrapped his body and sealed up the grave. So I know how you feel. His death was so real, but please listen and hear what I say. I've just seen Jesus. I tell you, he is alive. I've just seen Jesus, our precious Lord alive. And I knew, he really saw me too. As if till now, I've just seen Jesus, and I'll never be the same. It was his voice she first heard, those kind, gentle words, asking what was her reason for tears. And I sobbed in despair, "My Lord is not there." He said, "Child, it is I am here. I've just seen Jesus. I tell you, he is alive. I've just seen Jesus.
And now to God, who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think. To God be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus now and forevermore. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Amen.